काय म्हणलं जात? हॅलो,
Yes, good morning everybody. I welcome you
morning,
all in this webinar. The resource person is joining within a short time.
Slow है इंटरनेट
Yes, sir. Good morning to one and all. I am Assistant Professor Umesh Katekar, NSS Program Officer, Dayanand College of Law, Latur. I welcome you all in this webinar. On behalf of NSS Department, we have been organizing a webinar series consisting of 5 lectures on various socio-legal issues, one day each. Today, we are presenting before you the second webinar. The topic of today's webinar is enforcement of rights through writ jurisdiction. The resource person of today's webinar is Advocate Rajesh G. Panchal sir. He is an eminent lawyer and social activist. He is also known as a fighter for social causes. He is with us. He is going to address in today's webinar. Now, I would like to request to our IC principal, Dr. G. Lakshman sir, to welcome today's resource. Lakshman sir, over to you.
Good morning, everybody. Our college is projecting a webinar under the National Service Scheme, NSS. It is for the benefit of the entire students of our college. By the efforts of Assistant Professor Umesh Katekar sir, NSS Program Officer of Dayanand College of Law, Latur. In this linkage, our college has made invitation to the resource person to deliver a speech through the webinar on the enforcement of rights through writ jurisdiction. In this astonishing and marvelous occasion, a warm welcome to the advocate, Mr. Rajesh Panchal, sir, Bombay High Court, Bombay. Sir, your presence is graceful. Thank you, sir. And for later.
Thank you very much, Lakshman sir, for your nice welcome address. Now, in first time, I want to hand over this session for introduction purpose to Dr. Gopal Panchal sir. Dr. Gopal Panchal sir, over to you.
Very good morning, respected principal sir. Dr. G. Lakshman sir, today first person advocate R. J. G. Panchal, authority in conduction of this program, Professor Patekar sir, very good morning. Advocate Rajeshwar Panchal, law graduate, Nanded University in 2005, and graduated at Mumbai in 2007. Actually, sir is practicing at the Central Administrative Tribunal at Bombay and Maharashtra Administrative Tribunal. Equally, he has been fighting for the cause of common people. His major successful works including the compensation to the victims of terror attacks, center and state both each paying 5 lakhs, total 10 lakhs. And secondly, the right of free education to all the Bahujanas in the state for the RT Act. As a result of the public interest litigation, petition filed and became the case. And the result in the government of Maharashtra, particularly education department, was compelled to issue the necessary circulars so that the very come to be in effect. He also got the case of various people serving in government before the tribunals, ranking from peon to super class one, particularly IPS, IAS officers who denied the equal treatment on account of their social identity, etc. Or
sir, you are on mute.
Sir, please unmute yourself.
Audible? Yeah, audible?
Yes. Yes. Yeah, now audible. Yeah.
Now audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay. So, I am going to introduce our today's resource person, Advocate Rajeshwar Panchal. He is law graduate from the Swami Ramanantit Marathwada University, Nanded. He completed his law degree in 2005. Then after, he post-graduated from the Mumbai University in 2007. And he is practicing since at the Bombay High Court. Equally, sir is practicing at the CAT and MAT, Central Administrative Tribunal, as well as Maharashtra Administrative Tribunal at Mumbai. He has been fighting for the cause of common people. His major successful works included the compensation to the victims of terror attacks and rightings. A center and state both are paying 5 lakhs, totaling 10 lakh rupees. And secondly, the right of free education to all Bahujanas in the state under the RTE Act as the result of public interest litigation petition filed by him. And he himself filed and becoming a PIL petitioner. He also fought the cases of various people serving in governmental agencies before the tribunal, high courts, ranging from the peon to the class one officers, including IAS, IPS, who are denied the equal treatment on account of their social identity, etc., or invisible atrocities. Besides, he also successfully fought a case of a person who participated actively in war between the Pakistan and India in 1990 and got an order from the court directing the state to allow him 10 acres of land and even a residential plot under the scheme. Besides, he has often raised legal issues affecting the Bahujanas or depriving them of their valuable rights to equality and right to having access to justice. So much, many, many things are to be placed on the record. Because of the time constraint, I'm not going to much. So I once again, thanks to Katekar sir for rendering me such opportunity to introduce the, a renowned forerunner for the social cause to advocate Sri Rajeshwar Panchar. So thank you very much. And now over to you, Katekar sir.
Thank you very much, Panchal sir, for introducing our today's chief guest. Now, we all are eager to hear Advocate Rajesh ji. Now, without wasting much time, I am going to request today's chief guest, Advocate Rajesh ji, to take charge of this webinar. Sir, please.
Thank you, sir. First of all, let me be grateful to express my words of gratitude to you for giving me this opportunity so that I can have interaction with all of you. And I thank the Honorable Principal of the College, as well as Dr. Gopal Panchal sir and Umesh Katikar sir. And I also welcome all the attendees of today's program. The topic that today we will discuss is the enforcement of our rights through the writ jurisdiction.
In fact, sir, excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, your video is not visible.
Video is not visible?
Yes.
Sir. No, sir, sir's video is visible, sir.
Visible, visible.
Yes, your video is visible, sir.
Okay, sir. Okay. Please, sir.
Am I audible clearly?
Yes, sir. You are clear audible and clear visible, sir. Please continue, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So today's topic that we have taken up for discussion is enforcement of our fundamental rights through the writ jurisdiction. Since the very expression right is very wider, and you might have studied into jurisprudence. There is a separate chapter on the concept of right, and it includes many rights like obligatory arising out of contractual obligation, IPR, and customary rights, etc. But today we will be focusing on those rights which can be enforced by the writ jurisdiction. Because as far as other rights are concerned, like customary rights or legal rights or contractual rights, we have ordinary remedy of going to a civil court with a civil suit. What is the relevance of the writ, and in what context and what kind of rights can be enforced through the writ jurisdiction? Before I go into the subject, let me highlight two important issues, two important concepts, which are very, very necessary for better understanding of this entire topic. The first aspect is the concept of judicial review, and the second one is the rule of law. Now, the concept of judicial review, or the particular expression, the term judicial review, doesn't seem to be, you know, employed by the constitutional makers anywhere in the Indian constitution. If you read the constitution of India, you will not find the expression judicial review. But however, entire writ jurisdiction is nothing but the exercise of judicial review, power of judicial review that is given to the court. So for that, we need to understand there is some basic concept. And according to that concept, the entire legal system is working. So there is a theory that is also famously known as Kelson's law theory. And according to that Kelson's law theory, there is a layer of laws. Okay. So for example, there is a storied building. First floor, second floor, third floor, fourth floor, like that. So we have a multi-storied layer building, we can say, and the topmost or the law that falls into the first layer, the apex layer, is the Constitution of India. Thereafter, there comes the enactment or the acts enacted by the legislature. Now in India, since we have a federal system, we have a parliament at center, and we have a state legislature at the state levels. So the act either enacted by the parliament or the act enacted by the state legislature. So these would be falling into second layer after the constitution. Then there would be coming the third kind of law, that is called delegated legislation, or also you can say rules, which are often made by the government, because the act enacted by the parliament would empower the government to frame the rules to implement the act that is enacted by the lawmaking body. Now thereafter comes circulars or notifications or even the government resolutions, and these are called the executive orders. These are normally used because Constitution of India itself gives some power to the government, either state government or central government. There are two separate articles. They give the power to exercise the executive power of the government in case there is emergent need of some issue, and that issue needs to be immediately tackled, but the existing legal mechanism, existing law, existing legal position is not clear. Therefore, to tackle with the position, or even sometimes there is a law, but it doesn't meet with the circumstance. There is some gap, there is some lacuna. So to deal with such a circumstance, the government can exercise the executive power and immediately can come with some GR. That is called government resolution. If it is done by the state government, we call it GR. And similarly, when central government does it, it is officially known as a office memorandum. And that is normally framed by the particular ministry which is concerned with the issue, according to our list of subjects, etc. So this kind of law also falls into fourth layer. So what is the theory of this Kelson's theory of law? Is that the law that falls into the lowest rank would be subject to all other. For example, circular should be in consonance with the rule or act or the constitution. If it is found inconsistent with the above existing laws, then it would be null and void. Similarly, if the rule framed by the government is contrary or inconsistent with the Act of Parliament or Constitution of India, it is also null and void. Similarly, if an act of legislature is found to be inconsistent with the Constitution or particularly third part of Constitution, then it is also null and void. So this is nothing but this is called the Kelson's law theory. And judiciary is supposed to ensure that there is a rule of law. That means in this way, the supremacy of constitution is to be always maintained. So how to maintain the supremacy of constitution of India is done by the concept of judicial review. So now we are coming close to the issue, because the very concept of rule of law is that no one shall be above the rule of law. Entire country shall be, entire society shall be ruled by the law. there should be a rule of law rather than any individual human being. That is what famously Mr. Wade says. Now, in order to maintain this rule of law by maintaining the supremacy of Constitution of India, and in order to ensure that the all other laws are always in consonance with the Constitution of India, the judiciary exercises, and particularly there are two articles in the Indian Constitution which empower the higher judiciary. Now we are coming close to the subject of writ jurisdiction. There is Article 32 in the Indian Constitution of India which deals with the writ jurisdiction of Honorable Supreme Court. And then similarly, there is another article, Article 226, that deals with the same power of the High Court. Again, there is a basic small difference that we need to understand first before we delve into in-depth with this topic. Now, the writ jurisdiction of Honorable Apex Court of India is concerned, it is limited when compared to the writ jurisdiction of the High Courts, in the sense that the person whose fundamental right is violated can only approach the Supreme Court under Article 32. This is one aspect that has to be kept in mind. However, a person whose not only fundamental right is violated, but also his other legal right is violated, and he doesn't have anywhere the remedy to enforce that fundamental right or to get the redressal of that legal right. So that means the High Court, it can exercise the power of judicial review not only to enforce the fundamental right, but also some other legal right. And to explain these, to elaborate these, I will narrate few cases, few examples, including few cases which I have conducted. I have brought good results into those matters, so that this concept of in how the writ jurisdiction or writ remedy functions will be easily understood. So now let us refer to some cases of Honorable High Courts, and I will try to give at least major high courts and with regard to some major judgments to explain the concept of judicial review. Now you must be aware that there are five kinds of writs, namely habeas corpus, then mandamus, then certiorari, then quo warranto, and then prohibition. So habeas corpus is normally used in respect of criminal jurisprudence because it is to be used when somebody is illegally detained. Now, this writ was originally meant against the state power, but now with the advent of the judicial activism, this remedy is now even used in cases where somebody is missing and complaint is lodged to police, and the police machinery doesn't do anything. It doesn't investigate. It doesn't try to find out as to where that person has gone missing. In that case, the person who is affected, who is aggrieved, who is a complainant, can file a petition in the High Court under 226 and say that I have filed so-and-so complaint with particular police station, and despite my complaint, police station has done nothing to find that person, and we do not know whether that person is still alive or he is whatever has happened to his life. In that case, the Honorable High Court can exercise the power of judicial review, that is, issuing the writ, mandating the police to immediately find out as to what kind of investigation to file a report as to what kind of investigation you have done and what are the reasons that prevent you from finding the person, or if you find the person, then that person be produced in the court. So this sometimes now of late we have seen cases where even in order to get the custody of children, the petitions of habeas corpus are maintained by the court. When there is a dispute regarding the custody, though there may be some few cases, but still such kind of remedies exercised by the aggrieved person. Sometimes even recently I had an example. One fellow who was in an affair with a lady, and both of them belonged to different religion. One was belonging to Buddhism, and the lady was belonging to Islam. And then there was some family opposition as far as their marriage was concerned. So she was detained practically. Then that fellow approached me and he asked me, sir, what we can do in such matter? I told, you can file a writ of habeas corpus in the court, in High Court. But prior to that, we need to give a complaint to the police station, to a particular lady has been detained by her parents against her will and consent. And if police doesn't do anything, then we have a remedy of filing a writ in the High Court. And then accordingly, we prepared the complaint and we lodged the complaint with the police. But fortunately, the police understood the gravity of matter and police literally called the parents of that lady into police station. And the lady was produced in the police station and then she was handed over to that boy. And that is how they got married and they are now happily living. So these are the examples where the habeas corpus can be exercised. Now then, another kind of writ remedy, that is mandamus. Now, generally, mandamus is with regard to some action. And action is of two kinds. Action is inclusive, of inaction also. So we call act of omission and act of commission. So mandamus is when there is an act of omission. And that famously we call failure of discharging the duties. And particularly failure of discharging the public duty. You see, in a society governed by the rule of law, every department, every public person is supposed to act in terms of the law that will establish his office. You take example of any department of the government, there is some statute behind establishing the department. And that department, because it is a creation of the statute, there are duties. Those duties have been laid down in the very act or the very rules there under or very delegated legislature under as to how that department will function. And since, to give example of this, police department is the best example. Okay, police department is creation of CRPC, creation of police act at center level, creation of police act at state level, and there are duties. So simplicity duty is that whenever they receive a complaint with regard to commission of cognizable offense, there is a public duty to lodge the FIR. There is a public duty to immediately book the person who is accused, or there is reasonable suspicion that this is the person who committed the crime. And more so when the crime is heinous, then the police, for whatever reasons, sometimes a social background of that person, victim, he is not aware of his own right. Sometimes he is suffering from poverty like situation, and sometimes he himself being ignorant, he doesn't understand what to do, how to do. Then in that case, police will try to avoid. And there are so many such examples every day we come across nowadays. So what to do? Then in that case, the aggrieved person can approach the court and file a petition and ask the court to issue a writ of mandamus. Now, mandamus is what? The High Court will direct the police mandate the police to discharge the public duty by lodging and registering the FIR with regard to the offence concerned. Now this is called writ of mandamus. Give a specific example of this, I will give one case that I am presently handling. In 2016, there was a murder in Sangli, and then the complaint was very specific that these are the four persons who might have committed the offense because they had given a threat prior to that actual incident. There was some fighting, and in that fighting there was a threat that this man will be finished. And then suddenly after 2-3 days that man was found dead. And then these people, very poor people, and actually that very man who was dead, who was murdered, was a shet mazur, was a farming labor. Then he was left behind by his two small kids, a wife and two daughter, one son, and old aged parents. Where they can go? So they had been going to police station, and every time they visited police station, they were told that since they did not receive any report from the autopsy, they did not register FIR. And this way they killed long time, and ultimately they had to write to SP, they had to write to Governor, CM, and even up to President of India. Nothing happened, and then around a year passed in this, no FIR. And in this, the murder being the most heinous offense, the FIR was not registered. Then these people approached me through some friend, Then we filed a petition in the High Court, in Bombay High Court. Then Bombay High Court immediately issued the notice to the concerned SP as well as the senior police inspector, who is the station house officer of that concerned police station, within whose local territorial jurisdiction this murder took place. And they were called upon to file their respective affidavit explaining as to why they did not attend such a serious matter. Despite that, they did not even file the affidavit, and therefore, on the next date, the court imposed a fine, a cost of ₹5,000 to be given to each of the petitioners. And petitioners are the mother, father, and the wife, because we have made all of them as a petitioner party. And not only that, we have sought compensation from the government, because government has failed to maintain the law and order situation. And now there is a development of the victimology. There is a development of the right of compensation under even CRPC to the victim. So we have also made prayer for that. So this is another example where a writ of mandamus, a writ coming from the High Court, writ means an order, a direction coming from an High Court, directing the public functionary, directing public officers to discharge the public duties which are laid down in the statute. This is another example of the...
Sir, sorry to disturb you, but your yes, camera sir. Has been placed horizontally.
Okay.
Sorry, sir, for disturbance.
Okay, sir. Now okay, no?
Yes, sir, please.
Okay. Actually, some message intruded, therefore, this system changed. Okay, anyway. I was narrating about the writ of mandamus. So then the SP of Sangli and the senior police inspector of Sangli were subjected to cost that each to pay, both of them should pay to each of the petitioner. That came that the SP should pay ₹15,000 collect to the petitioners, and the senior PI should pay the ₹15,000 to the petitioners. And this was only interim direction. Now the matter is still pending in the court, and they did not even come with the affidavit, because now they are in difficulty, they are in problem. When murder has taken place, a poor man has died, and the system has failed. So just a minute. So now it is okay, no?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So call, if call comes in, then again it is getting horizontal. So anyway, the police themselves are in difficult situation, and they are unable to come with the reply, whatever reply they can do, because they have failed to discharge their public duty. Now this is the another example of mandamus. Then another writ is certiorari. Now let us understand the difference between the mandamus and certiorari. Now, as I said, action is of two kinds, and what we do, what the court does in the exercise of judicial review is to examine the process through which the action is done. Okay. It is said that the judicial review is of process through which the decision is taken, the action is done, not the action itself. So this action is either inaction or action, that is act of omission or commission. Now mandamus will come into play when there is inaction. The authorities, the public servants, are failing to discharge the duty. Now, for example, in another case, the action has been already taken, and that action is not according to the law, is not according to the existing rule, is not according to, or even it is against the law. It has been ignored by, it has been passed in ignorance of the existing law position. Then what is to be done? Then the person who is affected, who is aggrieved by such a action, such a decision, doesn't have any remedy. Now, in the remedy, in the sense, we must understand here, people get often confused about the meaning of remedy, statutory remedy. See, we while studying the concept of appeal, we must have understood that appeal is a statutory remedy and it is a right. When it is a statutory remedy, it becomes a right of the aggrieved person. A person who is affected, who, for example, in a civil suit, the person who loses the suit or whose suit has been dismissed is entitled to file first appeal as a matter of right, because that right of appeal is given by the statute. Then in few cases, there is a remedy of revision because it is given by the statute. Then apart from these remedies, there is a remedy of review also. Now, when any such action is not challengeable by way of either appeal or by way of revision or by way of review. Now, as far as review is concerned, it is very limited, and therefore normally we say that review is not a remedy. It is very limited, but still it is a statutory provision. So when you do not have any such remedy of challenging an action that is affecting you, then you are entitled to file a writ petition in the High Court seeking the writ of certiorari. Now this is the area where the writ of certiorari will come into picture. Now thereafter, writ of prohibition. Now generally speaking, writ of prohibition is rarely used, because this is a writ which will prohibit an authority which is doing something beyond his authority, beyond his jurisdiction. For example, an officer is doing something which he cannot do by virtue of his power, by virtue of his office. Then if he is allowed to do it, then the result would be affecting you. Result may be affecting your legal right, your fundamental right. Then you would be subjected to irreparable loss. Then what to do? Then you can file a writ petition pointing out to the court that this particular office, the particular authority is proceeding to do something that is beyond his capacity, beyond his power, authority and jurisdiction. Therefore, we request the court to issue a writ of prohibition prohibiting that authority from doing what he is doing. So this is the fourth kind of remedy of prohibition. It is rarely used and not like mandamus and certiorari, as they are often every day we see in the use. Then comes the writ of quo warranto. Now quo warranto is one of such a writ which is nothing but a kind of PIL. And the concept of PIL, the liberalization of concept of locus standi, is actually originating from the concept of this very quo warranto. Now quo warranto is what? Some person is occupying public post without holding the qualifications required to hold that post. Then the occupation by that ineligible person of a public post is against entire society. It is not against particular man. Therefore, any person of the society, any member of the public is entitled to file a petition in the court questioning that under what authority, when he doesn't have the local, when he doesn't have the eligibility, when he doesn't have the qualification required to hold the post, he is holding the post. There in such case, the court will issue a writ of quo warranto calling upon that person to produce the authority or the qualification that he will enable him to have the post. Now this very concept of quo warranto has subsequently given rise to the concept of PIL. Now dear friends, here we will PIL is nothing but a new kind of terminology used only to enforce the very rights, because in PIL only the name changes. The only thing is that in PIL the person who is petitioner may not be himself aggrieved, but what he is doing is exactly the same thing that aggrieved person can do. For example, if my right is violated, I will file a petition in a PIL, somebody else will file the petition. Just a minute. So PIL is nothing but a new kind of terminology to enforce the fundamental rights, to enforce the legal rights of the groups or of the people who are unable to approach the court on account of poverty, ignorance, and many other such factors. So these are the, and then in PIL, you know, the very reads that I have now spoken about are to be sought by the from the code. It is not that in PIL we ask for some different read that is not provided in the constitution. So now, with these basic ideas with regard to the writ, now let us move on to take examples of the cases that have been decided to understand how the this actually functions. Now, let me give an example to you from the Kerala High Court. 2-3 years before, there was a case in Kerala High Court. The child of the petitioner was suffering from a disease. That is very rare disease, and the treatment of the disease required 50 lakh rupees, and the father of the child was an auto rickshaw driver. He was unable to meet with the requirement of treatment, and his child was in the absence of the treatment is on the deathbed. What is to be done? Then that person filed a petition in the Honorable High Court of Kerala. Now see here the Kerala High Court. Now see when you say the right to life, Article 21. It has been expanded so widely that so many rights have found shelter into Article 21. Right to, a free medical aid is one of such rights which has been read into Article 21. Now, when you say that Article 21, the life means, right to have the treatment, the medical treatment, and that too free of cost. And when, now in such example, when it is declared that my fundamental right guaranteed to me under Article 21 also includes the right to medical treatment, but the treatment is so costlier that I cannot afford, what is to be done? Then the father filed a petition in the Honorable Kerala High Court, and Kerala High Court issued a writ mandating the government of Kerala High Court that government of Kerala shall take the burden of paying the entire fees of 50 the expenditure of 50 lakh rupees to the child. And the Kerala High Court made it clear that being a poor will not disentitle you from the enjoyment of the fundamental right that is guaranteed by the Constitution of India. So this is one such example. See how the fundamental right that is expanded is actually enforced by the Kerala High Court in this particular example. Okay. Now, another example that I would like to give is from the Orissa Court. Here, Raju. त्या एटी मॅडमला फोन कर म्हणा साहेब जरा वेबिनार मध्ये आता तिला बरोबर फोन आला सर आय एम सॉरी एक्स्ट्रीमली सॉरी बिकॉज आय एम गेटिंग इंटरप्टेड बिकॉज ऑफ कॉल्स
ओके
इन ओरिसा हायकोर्ट देर केम अ केस now very interesting case, and particularly it is more relevant now since we are seeing the Andolan nowadays. There were some agitations against the government by some people, and as a part of that agitation, they blocked the road. And unfortunately, a child was suffering from some disease or you can say emergency, and the child was being taken to district hospital from that very road which was blocked by the agitators, and unfortunately the child could not reach the hospital and he died. Now here whom to hold responsible? Who is actually responsible for the death of this child? Because the agitators were doing their agitation, and as we say that in democracy, right to agitation, right to protest is very vital democratic right. So they did not deliberately do it. Then what is to be done? Who is to be held guilty? Then a petition came to be filed in the Kerala High Court by the father of the child. Then Orissa High Court. Then Orissa High Court passed very interesting order. Orissa High Court said, yes, all right. At one hand, the agitators were doing their job. But at the another hand, what were the police mercenary doing? When the road was being blocked, it was their duty to ensure that at least in such emergent cases, the road should be free to at least the ambulance, at least to such cases. And since police did not discharge the duty of ensuring this, then police must be held responsible. And because the police is the instrumentality of the state government, ultimately state government was held responsible because for the death of that unfortunate child. And here the Kerala High Court directed the state government to give compensation of few lakh rupees to the father on account of the death of this child. See, these are the cases where how the mechanism is going on, how the actually rights are getting enforced. Now I would like to give one example from our Bombay High Court. Very interesting case, I will say. But prior to that, let me explain the concept of right of free conscience under Article 25 of Indian Constitution. When we say right to Article 25, the concept of right to religion will come into our mind. But actually, when we read Article 25, it speaks about right of free conscience first, and then it goes on to say right of religion. So what is the meaning of right of free conscience has been explained by the Bombay High Court in this particular case. Now there were around 1,000 people who had formed a group, and the entire people of that group did not believe into any religion. They said that all the religions of the world are useless. They divided the humanity. They are actually the enemies of humanity, and because of the religion, people are not understanding the real value of life, and they are not enjoying the life to the fullest extent. And this was their ideology, and on this ideology they had formed a group, and therefore they stopped believing into any religion of the world. And they made a representation to the government that whenever they come across with any government department, they apply, they make applications, they make the form in regard to whatever government communicates. Generally there is a column, they will ask your religion. The government forms, the applications, various such things will ask you to write your religion also. So these people said that because we do not believe into any religion, we cannot be compelled by the state government to write our religion. When we do not say that we do not belong to religion, why we should falsely state any religion, because ultimately we do not believe. Then government said, no, you must belong to some religion. Ultimately they filed a petition in the Honorable High Court, and this was decided in way back in 2013. Very interestingly, the Honorable High Court, headed by Justice A.S. Oak, who is now heading Karnataka High Court as a Chief Justice, he explained the meaning of right of free conscience. What is this free conscience? And court also explained that religion did not be theistic religion. Religion did not be a religion where God is worshipped, because in India we have religions where God is not, existence of the God is not even acknowledged. For example, even High Court quoted some judgment of 1995 of Supreme Court, where Supreme Court had said that religion need not be theistic, and it gave example of Jainism and Buddhism, where the concept of God is not acknowledged. So taking this further, interpreting this idea further, the Bombay High Court said the right of free conscience means, if my conscience is telling me that you need not believe in any religion, you need not worship a God, and you are entitled to practice what your conscience says. Therefore, the Bombay High Court, interpreted Article 25 and said that if somebody's conscience is telling him not to believe into any religion, and then it is his fundamental right, then government of Maharashtra could not have compelled them to do such kind of thing. And therefore, now court made it clear that if you do not belong to religion, if you say that you do not want to belong to any religion, you cannot be compelled to say, you cannot be compelled to write your religion. So now see the idea, the fundamental right of free conscience of not believing into any religion. Now if somebody is believing, it is okay, no problem. But if somebody is not believing, then how to get this right enforced? Then this is the way, the petition under Article 226. Okay. Now, recently, similar case came to be entertained by the Madras High Court. In Madras High Court, party leader, a petitioner running a small party, files a petition. And in the petition, he seeks direction to the state government of Madras. And the direction sought was that, every statue of Periyar, Ramaswamy Periyar, in the state of Tamil Nadu, has a kind of inscription below the statue. And the inscriptions went on like this, something against the God. For example, if I remember correctly, the one who created God is, you know, Badmash, rogue. One who propagates the God is rascal. And one who believes in the God, ignorant. To the effect, these are the words. So the every statue of Periyar Ramaswamy had these kind of words below the statue. So the petition was filed that these kind of things are, and this, remember, Periyar never used name of any particular God. He said only God. Now God is not monopoly of any particular religion, because all religion that believe into God, they can take this to be against them also. So the petitioner filed saying that the, universal God, petitioner said this inscription below the Periyar Ramaswamy is against the universal God, and therefore words as appearing in the statue, on the inscription of statue against the universal God, are offending the religious feeling, or offending the feelings of the people who believe into the God, universal God, or to the everybody who believes in any kind of God. The Honorable High Court interpreted this very Article 25. Now see, interestingly, Article 25 gives us four different rights. Right to religion or right to free conscience. What does it say? Number one, practice, follow, and profess, and propagate. Now, High Court of Madras said, if the person who believes into God is entitled to practice it in his own life, profess, that means publicly declare, he can publicly say without any problem. That is the meaning of profess. That you publicly declare that yes, you belong to this religion, you follow the tenets of this religion, you worship this God because of this religion. And he can also propagate it. That means he can even make the, he can spread it. What he believes in can be spread by him. So similarly, court said that since it is the, fundamental right of an atheist also, because it is the right emanating from the concept of right of free conscience. If your conscience says that you do not need a God, all that you need is the rule of law. If you have a country, if you have a society which is governed by the rule of law, then you are entitled to not only practice that into personal life, you are entitled to propagate this. You are entitled to even publicly say it. So this was the kind of interpretation that is put on Article 25 by the Madras High Court of recent time. And the petition seeking such direction was outrightly dismissed. This is very beautiful order to be gone into. It runs into 80 pages, but I have tried to give an idea of. Just a minute. So this is the way that a right of free conscience is now being enforced by the court in this fashion, particular fashion. Now, with this different kind of cases, you might have had an idea as to how rights are getting enforced, the very valuable right, fundamental right. Now let me give another example from our Bombay High Court. And since we have decided this, we have entitled the today's topic as a enforcement of rights. So the cases that I have just explained are pertaining to fundamental right. Now let us take an example of another right that is not fundamental right, but that comes from some other source. As I explained in the beginning, there is a government resolution that is called executive power, an instrument of law, framed in exercise of the executive power given by the constitution. For example, Article 166 empowers the state government to frame such executive rule. So in exercise of such power, the government of Maharashtra had come with a GR of 1971, 31st December 1971. What was this year? Was that there was a Indo-Pak war, and so many people from Maharashtra participated into this Indo-Pak war. Some of them had laid their life to the country in defense of the country. Some of them were injured, and they became subsequently disabled for their permanent lifetime. And some of them displayed the gallantry and got the medals for the gallantry in the war. Now I came across with such a person who was oftenly seen in the high court sitting at the steps like a beggar seats, and he was carrying several documents with his hand, and nobody could see that he is a war veteran, he is a war hero who defended our country in 1971 war. And then one of my senior friend in Bombay High Court once invited my attention to this man, and he simply asked me, "Do you know who is this?" I said, "I don't know. I thought he's a beggar." He said, "He's a Indo-Pak War, 1971. I was shocked. I said, "This is the real condition of the war heroes. And when we talk, when we talk of the armies and their gallantry, and then we try to politicize it. And then when it comes to ground realities, what is this happening?" Then my heart was so broken that I immediately went up to that man, and I tried to take the entire copies. And I saw the news, some news that was published in the paper already, that the Indo-Pak war veteran is begging on the road like a beggar. And then there were some other news saying some minister was promising to this man to give something to him, but except 1,000 rupees, nothing was given. And then this man used to come, he used to write letters to Chief Justice of Bombay High Court, Chief Minister, Prime Minister of India. And then in reply to one such letter, he had a response from the Prime Minister of India that was given, I think, in the year 2000 or 6 something, that when Atal Bihari government was there, he was informed that the PMO regrets to inform that he is not entitled to get any kind of help from the fund that PMO has, because he doesn't meet with the requirement or criteria of the fund, that PM refund. So this was the material that he had. Then I took the entire copy with me, and I started searching because I wanted to do something for this man. And I was not aware, because normally such kind of GR, such kind of, the GR that I spoke about, the government of Maharashtra had GR in which a person who has laid down his life, or that means he died, or a person who has got injured and became subsequently disabled, or a person who has got a medal for the gallantry shown into, displayed into the war, is entitled to getting 10 acres of land if the land is non-irrigated, or 5 acres of land if the land is irrigated land. Apart from that, he is also entitled to get a residential plot of 300 square meters. Now see, this GR was not given wide publicity, and therefore this person was also not aware, even I being a lawyer also not aware. And then my search began to do something for that fellow. It around 1 year passed. Then after, because of my desire to do something, because of my desire to do something, I used to discuss and share this kind of things happening to army heroes. One of my friends who was serving as a steno in the high court, writ cell, that is the government pleader's office, he said, "Yeah, Rajesh, similar matter was decided recently by the court. There, a lady who is the widow of war hero was given some benefit of some GR and 10 acres of land, something." Then I immediately started searching, and then through that judgment, I realized that there is a GR, and under the GR, it is the right of such as army man to get the benefit of the land, agricultural land, residential plot, etc. Then immediately I filed a petition before the Honorable High Court that it is my right under the GR. Okay, now this is the right that is not fundamental right, but still it is a legal right that came to me by way of the government resolution that was done in exercise of the executive power given by the Constitution of India. But this right was unenforced. It was not enforced. Then how to enforce? Then we filed a petition seeking a writ of mandamus. Now, in this matter, Bombay High Court not only passed an order in our favor directing the government of Maharashtra to give all the benefits under the GR within a time fixed. Apart from that, government of Maharashtra was fined by the Honorable High Court, and 50,000 rupees as a fine was imposed on the government of Maharashtra in this particular case. And then this right that was actually came into existence in the year 1971 was actually enforced by us after 47 years. Now, can you imagine the person who actually defended our country had to live the life of drudgery, the beggary for entire his life, and at the verge of his life, anyhow we came into contact and we could get that right enforced. And fortunately this happened into his lifetime, because this was a kind of recognition of his bravery that he has shown, and he had received 2 bullets in the war actually. And because of that, we proved in the court that because of these war injuries I got disabled. And there were some letters issued by the commanding officer directing the collector office that you take care of this man because he's a war veteran. But nothing was done except those 2-3 letters. And only those letters of commanding officer came to our rescue, and High Court was convinced, yes, this is a case of war veteran. Now, this is the example. And then after the judgment that unfortunately, after a year around, that war hero, Hinduraw Jagannath Ingale, his name is, he actually died. Now his wife is there, and still our fight is going on because government is not giving the kind of land that is actually he's entitled to. So contempt petition is pending, but we will get that. Now this is another such example, the how right is getting enforced through the writ jurisdiction. Now let me give another example another nature. The concept of while introducing Gopal Panchal sir has referred to RT. And briefly, sir, time to jaasot nahi na?
Yes, sir.
Are we within time or I am exceeding the time?
No, sir.
Okay. So. RT, that is the right of education, that is a free education to the children below the age of 14. Originally, this was read into Article 21 by Honorable Supreme Court way back in 80s. But subsequently, again, that was overruled, saying that it depends on the budgetary allocations, budgetary capacities of the state. Therefore, it remained on virtually paper. But then, luckily, in the year 2009, we could see the constitution itself got amended and Article 21A got inserted. Now this Article 21A of Constitution of India is giving a fundamental right to the child who is below the age of 14. Now to implement this is now the constitutional mandate. Now this has to be implemented. What is to be done? So Parliament had to make a law. Now Parliament enacted an act, that is Right of Free Education to Children Act 2009, in the year 2009. Then how to implement this act? Then there is a mechanism under the act that every state will have to frame the rules in their respective states to implement the provisions of RT Act and the fundamental right of free education. Now, the original act has given the idea as to how the children are entitled. So, act has put the children into two distinct definitions. So one definition is the child belonging to a disadvantaged group, and another category is child belonging to weaker section. Now to put it very simple, a child who is backward child, a child who has been suffering or whose parents have been seeing the discriminatory system, or today we call backward, Dalit or Bahujan, whatever you say, are the child governed by this disadvantaged class. And the children, though who may not have belong to the social background, social backwardness, but today they are poor, their parents are poor, so they are also entitled. Therefore, a child who is poor or whose parent is poor, and how to decide it is poor. So state government will fix a benchmark. Okay, for example, in Maharashtra we have fixed a benchmark of rupees 1 lakh rupees. A child whose parents' annual income is below 1 lakh rupees is a child belonging to weaker section. Now in other states this very benchmark is even up to 3 lakh rupees. In other states it is up to even 60,000 rupees. So I carried out a research into entire act, because I had another case where a daughter of my friend, despite having got a lottery, was not being admitted by the college school in Pune. Therefore we filed a petition in High Court, and when I started reading the act and the rules there under, then I realized ki this is a short individual case, but the government has done a very very dangerous thing. It has negative, it has narrowed down the very rights of all children belonging to various backwards in Maharashtra. So what has government done? Government, in exercise of the rule making power, had virtually amended the definition of the disadvantaged group, and those children who are entitled to be into the disadvantaged group, because see what is the purpose here. If you are in a disadvantaged group, the annual income of parent is not to be seen. Okay, so a child whose parents income may be whatever it is, but once it is a child belonging to disadvantaged group, is entitled as a matter of right. Therefore now see here, therefore we say article 16 is a very concept of reservation. The economy is not a criteria, social backwardness is very important. Okay, so here when you say the disadvantaged group, the child belonging to the categories that are declared to be the backward categories by the state concerned must be falling into the concerned disadvantaged group, and the children who do not fall into this category but still they are poor and still they are entitled, they should be put into weaker section. This is the original scheme of act. This was changed virtually, and except two classes, that is SC and ST, all backwards, that is OBC, SCBC, NT, VJNT, all other classes were taken out from this disadvantaged group and were put into weaker section. That virtually meant that in addition to being a OBC, that in addition to being NT, VJNT, whatever it is, your parents' income should be less than 1 lakh rupees, then and then only you will get this right as a fundamental right. I found this virtually amended the act of parliament. Then simply sitting, I filed a PIL where I myself became petitioner, and I only question. Now see, here we are dealing with the writ of certiorari, because action is already taken, rules are already framed, and those rules are against the act of parliament. In the beginning I explained the concept of Kelsen theory of law. There is a layer: constitution, act, and the rule. Now here is the example. These rules are against the act of parliament. Okay, so I filed a PIL questioning the government of Maharashtra that under what provision of law you had the power to amend what parliament had enacted. Government was unable to answer, though it tried to prolong the matter for 2 years, but till last it could not answer the query. Ultimately they had to agree that they had committed a blunder mistake, and they wanted to undo it. So I told the court, my lord mayor, promise is not going to help us, because every day is resulting into violation of fundamental right under article 21 of all the kids in Maharashtra every day, and they have been doing it from last 5 to 6 years, because these rules were made in 13 or 15 something. Therefore I said that whatever they wanted to do, they must be directed by the court, so that if they do not do, then they will be held in contempt. So immediately High Court passed an order, and they had to immediately enact a GR, frame a GR. That GR is dated 17th May 2018. And there they corrected the mistake, and they said the original concept of the disadvantaged group would include all these classes. Like they said OBC, all classes. Everybody who is declared backward, whatever by name it is called, NT, VJNT, whatever. Now therefore, these all children are entitled. See, the idea why this was done, because our societal system is such that the people belonging to this backward class, backward communities, do not have the capacity to stay into the town. Okay, because they have been sent out of the sieve, that is the boundary of the village. Even today if we go to villages, we will see this kind of structure of our society, and the schools are primarily located into the town, that is the core center of the cities, and there the idea of this act is that the children residing into 3 km radius of the school are entitled in the first place. So people who do not have residence, their capacity is not to stay in the 3 km radius, are already sent out. Okay, so this was an indirect scheme up to virtually negating this right of fundamental right. So I understood this idea and I ensured that this has to be dealt with in particular manner. Luckily and fortunately, with great efforts, I could succeed into that matter, and today the children are getting benefit every year. Now even this year also, lakhs of children will get benefited. Now another example that I would like to give is of another such petition, where I will be explaining the meaning of Article 21 and particularly with regard to compensatory jurisprudence. Now see, after I came to Bombay, in 2005. I did law in master degree in Bombay University, and around 2008 or 7, I might have started actually doing practice as a lawyer. By that time, we witnessed several bombings in Bombay, and with regular interval, particularly railways and then buses, and then this, this created a kind of fear into the mind that we had a sense of insecurity. Every day we step out the home, we will have a feeling into the mind that perhaps anything may happen anytime and we may not be safely returning to the home in the evening. So this was the sense of security with which we were living. And then this was continuously going on. Then suddenly came this, we saw this biggest Kasab attack, then several attacks. Then I started noting down. A kind of research began. Then in the year 2013, November something, I then filed a petition in the Honorable High Court. And I gave a table that how many attacks in India have taken place right from 1993 onwards till the date of filing the petition. And prior to the filing of petition was the last blast that took place in the Bodh Gaya temple, or near the Bodh Gaya temple in Bihar. The entire India, I got a table that the people died, the people injured, and the date and the timing and the etc. So the people who died were around 4,000 at the spot. That was the number figure at the spot. And the injured were innumerable. I gave an example to the court, my lord. If I am walking on the road, and on road I meet with an accident, and in the accident I get injured, I either get permanently disabled or either I get died. Then we have a law, we have a mechanism, legal system, that is the Motor Vehicle Act. Motor Vehicle Act gives a right to my dependents. They will go to the Motor Vehicle Tribunal. They will file a petition. In the petition, they will point out, see, this man was earning this much. His monthly income was this much. If he would have lived for this much years of period, he would have, earned this kind of money. This is formula given under the Motor Vehicle Act. According to that formula, my dependents would be given the benefit of the compensation. This sometimes goes into crore, I have seen. What if I meet with an accident, not an accident, but with such a terror attack in such a bombing? Where do we have a system? Where do my dependent go? Because you do not have a statute, you do not have any mechanism, you do not have anything. Then on what basis we are boasting ourselves to be a welfare state? And what level we are going to tell the entire world that we are going to become Vishwaguru? If you are not able to protect your citizens, and when you fail to protect your citizens, you are not even recognizing your liability of paying the compensation to your own citizens, in what capacity you are making such a claim to the entire world that you are going to become Vishwaguru? This I actually argued in the court. Then court understood the gravity of the matter, and court on the first day directed that the highest officer of the government of India should appear in the matter with the reply. Similarly, highest officer of the government of Maharashtra should file affidavit. Similarly, court called upon the additional solicitor general of India to represent the government of India. Similarly, advocate general of Maharashtra state was directed to remain present in the court to understand the gravity of the matter. Then I said, my lord, my only desire is that we must have a right of getting compensation, and therefore you should declare that Article 21 not only includes a simple life, the right to life includes a protected life, or I should have a feeling of safety. The feeling that with which I come outside should not be present in the mind, and we should be living with a sense of security that yes, we are free, we are protected. This should be the feeling of citizen when he is walking freely on the road. Otherwise, my lord, there is no meaning to Article 21. Then court literally virtually declared that right to life means protected life and the life with the sense of security and safety. This is what Bombay High Court has declared. And then what is the effect of declaring such? Since right is always correlative with duties, and fundamental right is always correlative with the duties cast upon the government. When it is my fundamental right, it is the duty of the government to enforce it. How to enforce it? And what if the government fails to enforce it? What if the government fails to protect my life? Then I said the failure of, you know, protecting the fundamental right of my life should be compulsorily resulting into paying the compensation. That will put a kind of, failure of duty. When you pay me compensation, you admit that you did something wrong, therefore you are compensating me. The very term compensation is, you know, inclusive of liability. You are recognizing that you did something wrong. You failed to do something, therefore you are compensating me. Therefore, the court directed that every failure to protect the fundamental right should result into paying the compensation. So to this level, the idea of compensation has gone. Now, therefore, I would say I am still working on that aspect, that the every violation of fundamental right should be necessarily resulting into compensation being paid. In simple word, we should say that right to compensation itself should become a fundamental right in case there is a failure to enforce the fundamental. So luckily, as a result of this, we got even as a side effect of this matter, we can say by product of this matter is this, that immediately Government of Maharashtra issued a notification under section 357A of CRPC, that every female who is victim of the heinous crime of rape is to be given 3.5 lakh rupees immediately, regardless whether accused is brought, whether accused is punished or whatever. She is entitled as a matter of right to this amount. If similarly any female is victim of such acid attacks, then also she is entitled to this much amount, that is 3.5 lakh rupees. Similarly, if anybody is murdered, for example, as I give example of my own case in Sangli, if anybody is murdered, then regardless whether who committed murder, regardless whether the actual person is caught and prosecuted and punished, the family of the deceased who is murdered is entitled to get immediate compensation from the Government of Maharashtra, 2 lakh rupees plus 25,000 rupees for the funeral. So this is the, why this is, because the government has failed to maintain the law and order situation in society to such a level that the miscreants are going to such an extent that they are taking life of somebody else. So responsibility must stand on the shoulder of the government. This was the idea behind this. Like in the case of enforcement of fundamental rights vis-a-vis bombings. Luckily, this is the byproduct, and as far as main matter was concerned, Government of India also and Maharashtra also said that yes, this is the issue pertaining to the national security, and only the Cabinet of India is competent to reframe the rules, reframe the policy on this. Accordingly, Bombay High Court declared, and it wrote a judgment running into 22 pages something, dated 13th or 14th August of 2014. That is still available on the official website. Now that judgment is very beautiful judgment, because this one reading of the order, the reading of this one order will give you an idea as to how the concept of compensation or right to life is getting expanded day by day. So as a result of this, then the Government of Maharashtra came with the case that now they will pay 5 lakh rupees, and central government will also pay the 5 lakh rupees. But court made it very clear this should be with effect from the earlier date when you said that you will pay 1 lakh rupees. So as a result of that, the policies came into effect from 2003 or one something. So many people who were victims, unfortunate victims in Kasab attack and subsequent attack, were actually given the benefit. And still, in my PIL, the last order is saying that if anybody is not, has not got it as of now, is entitled to come to this court and point out, we'll pass the order. So these are the recently TISS, that is TISS, they are also doing a kind of project on this. They contacted me, and they are collecting the data with regard to such people who are victim across the India, who are not getting any such benefit or who are not given. So still our work is going on, because this is a lengthy process to gather the data, etc. So these are the examples. I think I have given around 1 hour and 30 minutes. If you permit me, I will take 2 or 3 cases and finish the matter. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, please carry on.
Okay. So now we will come to some aspect which is very which is not healthy, which is not welcoming sign that our system is suffering from. Basically, this is the hard reality of our society itself, because we are living in a society which is actually suffering from the inequalities. And since down the centuries, we have been witnessing this kind of things and we are still struggling to come out of it. And our system, basically system in the sense the judiciary or the government or executive or legislature, it is not falling from the heaven. We the people go into the judiciary or executive or the legislature. Therefore, societal conditions in which we are growing up will make our mindset, and with this very mindset we'll go and we'll do the same thing. So the system also is suffering from such kind of inequalities when it comes to enforcing the fundamental rights. So this is now the very important aspect. To explain this, I will give one example. In the year 1983, we had 2 cases in Supreme Court. In one case, one petitioner, that is Rudal Shah, was given compensation of rupees only 30,000 rupees as against his illegal detention of 14 years. Okay. In this case, what had happened? He was acquitted by the Sessions Court in which he was accused. Despite his acquittal, he was continued to be detained in the jail for 14 years, and ultimately he wrote a letter to Supreme Court, and that letter was treated as a writ petition under Article 32, and inquiry was directed, the district judge was directed to look into the matter, and report came. The jail authorities tried to evade this by saying that he was insane, he was mad, therefore we did not allow him to go outside, otherwise he was danger to the society. To that effect, they did a drama to save themselves, but ultimately a court put them to question, if at all he was suffering from the insanity, then you must have given the treatment to him. You show us what is the treatment that you give. So they were unable to show. So that is how they got exposed. But court gave only 30,000 rupees as a compensation to that Rudal Shah. In the same year, another case where a person was given 50,000 rupees for illegal detention of only 1 day. And this is the case of Bhim Singh versus State of Jammu and Kashmir. The reason was that he was MLA. Okay. So now these are 2 cases before your, yourself. You compare how the system functions. A poor man who was illegally kept in jail for 14 years is getting only 30,000 rupees as compensation, whereas a celebrity, powerful man, political man, for 1 day is getting 50,000 rupees. So this is the hard reality of our system. And we are struggling hard every day to come out of it. And it is duty of everybody to contribute into this fight, so that our judiciary shall be actual judiciary which is truly going by the constitutional ethos of equality, that is the rule of law. The concept of equality is the hallmark of the, without the equality you cannot say that you are living in a society governed by the rule of law. Okay. When we see such kind of cases, can we say with the whole heart that yes, we are living in a society which is regulated by the rule of law, because there is a equality? Of recent times, we take example of cases like Arnab Goswami. Immediately he was granted bail by the Supreme Court. In other cases, so many people are incarcerating in the jails. Why? Because they are hailing from poor background. They are common men. Nobody knows them. They are hailing from some social background. The identity is backward. Okay. So these are the realities, and we are trying to because the very faith of people is the foundation of judiciary. In these kind of cases, in fact, we are not happy to tell these kind of things to people. Now people are realizing it, people are watching it from their open eyes, that these are the things happening in the judiciary. So when people will watch this, people will see this, people will lose the faith in the system. And when people will lose the faith in the system, what is going to happen is nothing but a banana country, rule of banana. Okay. Everybody will become mighty is righty. That is called, famously, Justice Karju said, if we fail to use danda, danda in the sense nyaya, nyaya shastra, that is equality. If we fail to use danda, then the entire, you know, samaj will become machli bazar. Then, you know, mighty is right. He refers to some slokas. The meaning is like this only. Therefore, equality becomes, the sanction of equality is very, very important in every aspect of life, whether it is judiciary, whether it is legislature, whether it is, see, we challenge an act of parliament saying that it is violative of equality, okay, and it is set aside by the court because it is violative of equality. Similarly, we must see, the judiciary must lead by the example. Justice not only should be done, it must appear to be done. Okay, we keep on saying, we do not get tired of saying this. But these are the cases which show us some other picture that is not a good picture. And as a member of this legal fraternity, legal community, it becomes the duty of everybody to contribute into this fight so that we are up to the mark. The entire world shall look at us with the, you know, pride that yes, this is the country where the rule of law is very strictly followed. I read into some book, actually, some novel, the author says, that actually, countries where the democracy is not in existence are following the equality more than the countries where democracy is there. For example, a country like China or country like North Korea, there they follow the equality better than the country like India. Okay, this is the reality. Now, with these, I think I should stop here so that if anybody wants to raise any question, then I'll try to answer those also. And with these dear friends, I'm once again very much thankful to all of you, and I'm thankful to Dr. Panchal sir, Katekar sir, and honorable principal of the college, and all other attendees of today's program. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. It was an excellent opportunity for us to hear you. During your address, you have raised the real scenario in before our eyes in relation to writ jurisdiction, compensatory jurisprudence, and other relevant matters. Your address was coupled with vast experience in the area of social activism. We are really obliged, sir. Now, I request two participants to ask their questions to clear their doubts. Yes. Any question, any doubt?
Yes, sir.
Yes, who is there?
Yes, Vijaya Birala.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, Vijayanand, ask.
Okay, sir. सर माझा प्रश्न असा आहे गेस्ट लेक्चरचा की पोलीस एफआयआर दाखल करून घेतल्यानंतर पुढे जे इन्व्हेस्टिगेशन करत असते किंवा इन्व्हेस्टिगेशन करण्यासाठी काय काय त्यासाठी आपण काय
आधी पंकज होतो का
येस विजयन रिपीट युअर क्वेश्चन बिकॉज वी कुड नॉट हियर यू
व्हॉइस इज अनक्लियर
ओके जर पोलीस एफआयआर काढून एफआयआर दाखल करून घेतल्यानंतर पण पुढे त्या एफआयआरवरती कोणत्याही प्रकारचे ऍक्शन घेत नसतील म्हणजे आरोपींना पकडणं असेल त्यांना अटक करणं असेल किंवा कोर्टामध्ये चार्जशीट फाईल करणं असेल तर असं करत असतील पोलीस आणि वेळ लागत असतील तर आपण त्यांच्यावरती कोर्टामध्ये
yes,
actually, voice is not clear. Let him put into chat box so that it can be read out.
Yes, Vijayanand,
please put your question into chat box. We can answer it.
Sir, I think he is asking when the police authority is not cooperating with us after lodging a complaint.
Okay.
Then what we have to do?
Yes, sir.
Yes, what are the...
Is this the question?
Yes, sir. Okay. Yes, yes.
Yes. Now see, the Supreme Court in the case of Anita Kushwaha versus Sudhan Kushwaha, that is decided by Constitution Bench in 2015, has declared that right to have access to justice is a fundamental right under Article 14, read with 21. Okay. Now see, if you are victim of an offence, you are entitled to have access to justice. Now, a victim of offence is having access to justice at the first stage at the police station. Okay. So the very stage of access to justice begins from the police station. Now, if the police doesn't entertain your complaint, it doesn't help you, then you have two remedies. The first remedy is that if the offense is so serious that it shocks your conscience, then you can directly file a petition under Article 226 in the High Court and seek a direction to the police concerned to do the FIR as well as investigate independently. In case you believe that the police are managed by their side and they will not do carry out independent investigation, then they will you can file a petition in High Court seeking that the FIR should be lodged and investigation be done by some independent machinery, different machinery than the actual police. And the ordinary remedy is to file a complaint under 156(3) before the concerned magistrate. So these are the remedies. And additionally, let me tell you, in Maharashtra now we have a state police complaint authority. Okay. Now state police complaint authority is entertaining the complaint against the police. Now failure to register FIR is a misconduct and also an offence now under the IPC. Now if you read section 166, also section 166A, these are the offences committed by the public servant. A police personnel is a public servant and refusing to register FIR is nothing but showing disobedience to the direction of law. Therefore, the act of failure to register an FIR becomes an offence by the hand of police under section 166 and also 166A, for which you can also prosecute. And let me tell you, as far as offence under section 166A is concerned, you are not required to get even sanction, that is under section 197 of CRPC, because explanation to that section says that the to prosecute the public servant under 166A, sanction is also not required. So you can directly go and lodge the case against the concerned police personnel as far as 166A is concerned. Additionally, you can make a complaint to the state complaint police authority, and there are regional authorities also, police complaint authority. There you can make a complaint that and these are the misconduct, so they can be subjected to departmental inquiries. They can be penalized with the harsher penalty like dismissal, removal from service, suspension, etc., etc. So these are the effective remedies to ensure that police will act in terms of the law. You got my point?
Yes, sir. But then my question was that the police have already registered my FIR, but now the police is not performing their duty. It means they are not performing their duty to arrest the culprit, etc. What should I do now? I have already asked so many times the particular concerned police officer to investigate the matter and go and arrest that culprit. But the police is not working as per the rules.
Okay. That you mean to say that FIR is registered, but they are not discharging the duty of carrying out fair investigation, and as a part of fair investigation, they are trying to avoid even arrest of the concerned accused. Okay. So what is the remedy? Isn't it?
Yes. Yes.
So yes. In such case, you can file a writ petition under Article 226 in the High Court, and you can establish that the police are not discharging their duty of doing a fair investigation. And see, there is a beautiful case on this aspect, case State of Gujarat versus Babu Bhai Patel. Okay, you can take down. Very interesting case. State of Gujarat versus Babu Bhai Patel, or Babu Bhai versus State of Gujarat. You put in the Google, you will get it. There, the court, the Supreme Court says that the police are the protector of the liberty and they should carry out the fair investigation. Because we say that Article 21 includes a right to fair trial. Now let me just imagine, if the investigation itself is not fairly done, whether it is possible to have a fair trial? So in the absence of fair investigation, it is impossible to have a fair trial. Therefore, it is violation of Article 21. So such cases where the police are not doing investigation fairly, that is resulting into the violation of Article 21. And on that line, you can file a petition in the High Court. And you can seek necessary direction, including arrest also.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, and now, but however, as far as the law regarding arrest is concerned, it is now, as after 14, that is the case of that Arnesh Kumar case. Okay, and there should not be automatic arrest. The arrest has to be justified. So subject, because every offense doesn't mean that the moment cognizable offense has been registered, the accused must be arrested. It is not like that. And therefore, the arrest has to be justified. To subject to this, you can ask even direction to arrest also.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yes, any other question from participants? Okay. Now moving forward, I request to one of our volunteers, Ananta Sule, please propose your talk. Thanks. Ananta, over to you.
Thank you, sir. I'm audible, sir?
Yes, Ananta.
Okay, thank you, sir. Baron Pulsifer once said, from young to old, there are two words that carry a person forth in grace and honor, that is please and thank you. I, Anand Sule, LLB third year student, consider the occasion as an honor and privilege to extend the oath of thanks. Today, I take the opportunity to put all my gratitude into words. On behalf of the National Service Scheme of the Anand College of Law, Latur, and all the students, I would like to thank our chief guest, His Highness Advocate Rajesh Panchal, sir, for taking his precious time out and consenting to be the chief guest. Sir, your thoughts have enlightened our minds and shown us a new path. Today's webinar was full of knowledge and interesting things. It gave deep insights into the topic and reveals some interesting facts. The information given by Advocate Rajesh Panchal, sir, about enforcements of rights through REIT jurisdiction is really informative. I'm pretty sure the precious knowledge that Advocate Rajesh, sir, gave us will definitely help us in our future life. So thank you, sir. We have been fortunate to be guided by our principal, Dr. G. Lakshman, sir, to arrange this webinar series. You have given a strong support and a lot of encouragement. Thank you, sir. I also would like to thank Assistant Professor Dr. Gopal Panchal, sir, for giving support to this to conduct this webinar. My big thank you for Assistant Professor Katekar, sir, for arranging such informative webinars. Last but not least, I thank you all the professors, students, fellow mates and volunteers for showing interest in the program and making the program successful. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Ananta. Now, we are really obliged, sir, by your guidance. Thank you very much. Now, with the permission of our principal, Dr. G. Lakshman, sir, my respected colleagues and participants, I take an opportunity to declare that this program has been concluded. Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.